and thanks for watching this Life Solved short, where we'll meet another researcher starring in this latest series of Life Solved, the University of Portsmouth's podcast about world-changing research. I'm Robin Montague, and this time I'm talking with Dr. Peter Cruddas. Cast your eye back to last year. It may seem a distant memory now, but it was England's hottest summer on record and the driest since 1976. In fact, the warm year has left us facing some really tough questions, not just here in the UK, but about water security and supply around the world. Peter's here today to discuss how research happening here at Portsmouth could help us tackle the UK's water supply crisis as we face increasingly warmer temperatures. Thank you for joining me, Peter.
Pleasure to be here.
Peter, just take us right back to the beginning and how you ended up in this field. What interested you about water supply and engineering, and how did you get to where you are now?
Well, I think university was the first step, doing civil engineering. I think I'd always had a kind of scientific maths engineering focus. My dad was an engineer in a different discipline. But I went to do civil engineering, which involved a lot of kind of concrete and structural calculations. But I did a sandwich degree, so I had a year in industry in the middle of my course, which we kind of offer here, and I think it's a fantastic opportunity. It gives you a chance to go out and experience the workplace before you finish. And I got the opportunity to go to Botswana to do my year in industry. And it was a company that had built a lot of schools because the country was developing quite fast. They were pumping a lot of their own money back into their own infrastructure. So I had this wonderful idea, be going out and building schools in Africa. And the job that they had at the time I came out was actually building a geology mine for the De Beers Diamond Company. So it wasn't really what I had been envisaging. But as it was this kind of geology camp, we're set up in the middle of the desert, miles away from anywhere for kind of security purposes. And we had to tank all of our water in. So I was building some of the infrastructure for the camp, things where they were going to live, the toilet blocks, shower blocks and so on. And so I was needing water to do the construction. You need a lot of water to build things, to make concrete and so on. The geologists were already on site, so they needed a lot of water to wash their samples and do their processing. And then we all needed water every day just for brushing our teeth and washing and stuff. So it really, even though I went there on a kind of structural, kind of more traditional civil engineering route, it really opened me to my eyes to the idea that, okay, water is really important for so many different reasons, and there's these conflicts around when you don't have enough water. How do you prioritise? Do I do a concrete pour today and the geologists have to wait till their samples tomorrow? Shall we make sure we have enough water to kind of drink and wash our food and our clothes these days? And so I came back from that, and that really just indicted me onto the water route.
Just walk us through why we take it for granted here in the UK and how robust is our water supply here?
Yeah, I mean, that was really what opened my eyes to Botswana. I'd got to that stage in my life and 2 years through a civil engineering degree without ever really thinking about water, because you turn on your tap and it magically appears. You turn off your tap and it magically disappears down the sink, or you flush your toilet, it magically appears, cleans your toilet, magically disappears again, and you think nothing more about it. And it was only when I was having to really, you know, see where the water was coming from and what's happening to it, you realise that there's an awful lot of work that goes on to get the water to that tap in the first place, and to take it away and try and get it to the environment in at least a reasonably good shape at the end of it. And it is something, this kind of water invisibility that we have in the UK, that we're just so used to having everything on tap and everything disappear without thinking twice about it. I think it almost devalues water for us, that we don't really appreciate all of the impacts that it's having to get it there and to get it away again.
And our water supply here in the UK, give us a bit of a history of where we're at now, because a lot of the infrastructure is fairly old, isn't it?
Yeah, so going back really into the, I guess it would be the 18th century, the 1700s was when we really started to see water supplies getting brought close to people as we started urbanising. It was a lot harder for people to go and just get water from local sources. And then in the 19th century, it really came to a head, is that we had, especially in London, so many people, water had been brought in, pumped in, companies were now bringing it in to kind of get it to people's houses. And then the amount of water that we started using, having this convenience of having it in your house, meant people were using a lot more of it. And then it was a question of where did that go afterwards? And a lot of it was ending up going straight back into the Thames. And in the middle of the 19th century, we had what's known as the Great Stink, where we used to have a separate sanitation system where our toilets would be kind of pits separate, and then all of the kind of surface water, rainwater, would drain back into the Thames. When the wonderful water closet idea came along, it was actually a terrible thing for sanitation because it just mixed all of our waste in with loads of water. It couldn't kind of sit in a cesspit anymore. It ended up going into the Thames as well. And it got so bad that London in 1858, the smell off the Thames was so bad Parliament could even sit. They had to go and find somewhere else to meet because the smell in there was just too bad for them even to kind of have a meeting.
Oh my God. You can just, yeah, you just envisage the whole city just kind of cowering away from anywhere near the water's edge. And I suppose that sort of has a knock-on effect on the rest of the UK as well, doesn't it? Because the way that we access water here in the UK, it is sort of a downward stream process, isn't it? Do we take it all from the rivers, or how do we actually get our water?
Yeah, so a lot of it is from surface water, but it changes from place to place. For example, here in Portsmouth, most of our water comes from groundwater sources, so from aquifers, rocks under the ground that store the water, and we pump it up. I mean, the two systems are really very heavily linked, which a lot of people don't appreciate how kind of interrelated the two forms are. But we have this very centralized system now, so we will pump up the water, or pump it out of a reservoir or lake. We'll take it to a treatment center, try and get it to drinking water standard, and then we'll distribute it from that kind of one point to lots of people in different parts of a catchment. And then again, once we've used it and it goes back into the sewers, into the drains, we then take it all away to a wastewater treatment plant, which would be one source for a large, city or large catchment. It all has to go through there to try and treat it before it goes out. So we're kind of very dependent on individual kind of point sources of where we get the water from, how we treat it. Then it kind of goes out to everyone, and then it converges again at a wastewater treatment plant before it goes into the environment.
So that all makes perfect sense in terms of the cycle of how we get our water. But why are we having issues now then? Why do we experience things like water shortages, for instance, like in the summer last year? And why are we having issues around sewage?
Yeah, well, I mean, it comes down to the centralised system and its capacity, really. So where we take our water from, our reservoirs or our lakes, there's only so much water that is there at any one point in the cycle. So we kind of talked about our human water cycle, where we get our water from, how we put it back into the environment. But that's obviously part of a wider water cycle, the natural water cycle, where probably everyone learnt about it in their kind of middle secondary school at some point. The oceans and the water evaporates up into clouds, and the clouds rain and it falls onto the land, goes into rivers, streams, or soaks in to the ground and into the aquifers. And eventually all makes its way out to sea and evaporates again. But what that means is that when you're trying to take water out of that environment, you're taking that one pinch point of kind of when the rain hits in a river, a reservoir, an aquifer, and you're trying to take it out at that point. So if that whole cycle isn't kind of consistent, so you haven't got rain for a while, for example, you draw down the reservoirs, you're still using the same amount of water, but it's not coming back in. And it's saying you can draw down your aquifers underground, and if they're not getting filled up again, then you're using water that isn't replacing, and that's when you start to have problems.
So we're at the mercy of the weather then?
Exactly, yeah, and that's not a good place to be at the moment with climate change, where weather's getting more extreme, we're getting larger droughts, we're getting longer floods, and it's more unpredictable, so it's very difficult to say year on year whether you're going to get a long drought, a big flood or anything. But flooding causes a problem as well to the system, because it ends up transporting the water a lot quicker. So whereas we'd like a kind of steady rainfall that could fill up a reservoir over a long period of time, if you have a huge flood, that reservoir might fill up, but then the rest of the water will kind of bypass and go back into the ocean. Or the amount of human development we've got, so the amount of paved areas we have now, mean that water that might have gone down into the ground, into the aquifers we could use, that shoots off to the ocean, and now it's kind of salt water, ocean water, not the fresh water in the aquifer that we needed. So the floods and the droughts are both kind of causing the problems, even though that seems a bit counterintuitive.
So we're in this situation now then that we really need to start paying more attention to this process and ways of improving it. What kind of things are sort of companies like, for instance, Southern Water, Thames Water, and also government looking to do?
So I think the one of the main drivers and one of the easiest things they can try and do is affect some kind of change in consumers. because the less water we use, the longer that our current infrastructure can take. So if we look at how much water we can responsibly take from our aquifers, or just how large our reservoirs and rivers are, how much water we can take from there. If every individual is using less water per person, that kind of water source will last longer, so it could get through a longer drought. There's a really fascinating example of this in Cape Town in 2017, where they had many years of a very prolonged drought, to the point where they looked at how much water was left in their reservoirs. They looked at how much water people were using and say, okay, we've got a date of a few months in the future. Kind of put the date in the diary. This is the date there'll be no more water for the whole of Cape Town. And Cape Town's a big city, well-developed city. And so they put in some extreme water-saving measures. They managed to actually save 500 million litres of water every day just by putting in water-saving measures. Now, some of them were a lot more extreme than you want to do in a day-to-day, but it kind of showed or highlighted to those people, you know, who were very used to, you know, having lifestyles like us of just turning on a tap, using water in the same way. Lots of swimming pools and golf courses in Cape Town. It's a very well-developed city. And they really had this squeeze, which showed them, you know, how far they could go. And I think it's about trying to find that balance of how far can we go and maintain, you know, a nice lifestyle, enjoy the benefits of having water supplied to houses, but try and make the most of it.
Now, when you say extreme measures, I remember growing up and being told to turn the tap off when you're brushing your teeth, not to leave water running for too long. I don't know if it's showers or baths are more water efficient, but there's all sorts of things. So that's kind of my version of measures. But when you say extreme measures, what are we talking about?
I mean, well, in Cape Town, it got to the point again, because they had a clear day of we'll run out. They had to go further than you'd want to do in a kind of normal day-to-day water efficiency, that they were looking at rolling water blackouts. So you might only get water for a few hours a day. So you'd have to kind of maybe fill up your bath and everyone would just have to bathe in that for the day, try and collect the water that you needed, you know, to use. And this is really very similar to work I've seen in less developed countries. I worked in Guatemala for a year, building water supplies for communities that didn't have it. And we would pipe down water, we'd construct a system to pipe down water from a spring that the community owned to the village. But that spring could be maybe an hour's hike away. And so if the people wanted water, they'd have to hike up this mountain for an hour, collect what they could carry. Water's really heavy when you actually try and carry a lot of it around, and then hike back down this mountain with a very heavy kind of load. And then you really get to think about, okay, how much water do I really need today? How many times do I want to go up this mountain and back with 10 kilogram weight on my head? So I think in Cape Town, that kind of rolling water out made that extreme. But other ways about thinking in gardens, for example, lovely, beautiful manicure green lawns are wonderful if you have got the water for it, and people spend a lot of time putting that in. But if we're starting to look at a future where we have less water and it's hotter, maybe, you know, adapting the kind of gardens we have to that kind of climate. And so I think, yeah, it's a case of not trying to get everybody to go backwards into an extreme where we're not getting the benefits of the piped water supplies that we have, but just trying to really think consciously about every kind of behaviour, really, and are we doing the most we can?
And if we were to carry on how we've been and not think consciously and kind of, you know, think, oh, well, we're a well-developed country, we've got plenty of water. How can we? I mean, it's England, we're always raining. if we do carry along that path, what is the likelihood of us experiencing a similar situation to Cape Town?
I mean, on a similar path, extremely likely. I think the thing is, it's very... The water cycle is extremely large, extremely complex. You know, the whole kind of weather patterns, where the water gets stored, how it moves through. It's very difficult to just kind of look out your window, see it raining and think, oh, great, that means suddenly we'll have lots of water tomorrow. It's a lot more complex than that. And I think what the water companies try to do is monitor these kind of groundwater levels, monitor these reservoir levels to try and check these and know that, okay, if it's 50% at the end of a winter, for example, in the summer you're going to use a lot more, recharge a lot less, and then you're facing problems. And you know, that was the issue with Cape Town, is you're just kind of two or three years of drought away from all of your buffer going, and that's what ended up happening. The first year you have a drought and your reservoirs are kind of 70% level, so you think, okay, there's no problem, it'll fill up next year. Second level, the second year there's more drought and suddenly your levels are at 30%. And then the third year, you know, it's kind of gone. So I think maybe a lesson a lot of water industries have learned around that is maybe trying to project ahead and thinking about these, what used to be a worst case scenario, but what's happening more and more of how many years of drought or how many months of drought would it take to really rock the system? And it's a lot less than we'd like. There's a really fascinating survey done during lockdown in August 2020, where about 2,000 UK residents were asked how much water they thought their household used in an average day. And 46% of them said they reckon their household used 20 litres of water or less. And so we use about 140, 150 litres per person per day. So a typical kind of four-person household is using around 500 litres of water every day. And half of the people surveyed thought they were using less than 20 for their whole household. So this kind of this idea of this invisible water that we don't really see how much water we're using because we don't have that connection means that, yeah, these water companies are having to supply an awful lot of water. It takes an awful lot of rain then to fill up the sources they need, and it doesn't all get there. So I think people, with hosepipe bans, they see water, they just think one day of rain, everything's going to be fine now. Whereas actually when you kind of look at it on a strategic level about the amount of water we're using versus how much rain actually gets to recharge our sources, then it becomes a much more complicated picture. And that's why things like hosepipe bans need to go on longer so that we can balance that whole system of that kind of unseen infrastructure underneath a lot better.
Fantastic. Thanks, Peter. That was really interesting. And 500 litres are just blowing my mind. I think many more people are wondering how the circular economy connects to things that we use and dispose of. And water is one that can easily be forgotten, unfortunately. But as we face some increasingly dry summers, it is good to know that research is going on to help this often overlooked world become more effective. So thank you. If you'd like to find out more about the project, listen to the full episode of Life Solved on the University of Portsmouth website or your favourite podcast app now. Just search for Life Solved. You can click the link in the comments box below or head to port.ac/research. See you again next time.